So we're in chapter 42. As you know, chapter 42 is the chapter that introduces, and we're going to talk the next few chapters, almost towards the end of Tanya, about the idea of fear of God, what that means in a meaningful way on two levels. Right now we're discussing the lower level. What we're discussing today really is a very interesting idea. Hi, Fran. We're discussing a very interesting idea, and that is how to make something personal. Meaning, how does our fear of God, how does our that which we have deep inside of us, how does that become personal? So we start off really discussing what is getting in the way of making it personal. Why sometimes don't we feel love, whether it's to a spouse, whether it's to a child, whether it's to a friend, whether it's to, in this case, God? Why don't we feel it, the fear or the love or the awe? And the answer is a very interesting answer. It has nothing to do with whether we have it inside of us. It has to do with how accessible it is. In other words, there are certain things in life that are not accessible to us. If I decide I want to be the world's greatest painter, or I want to be an amazing painter, some people have it within them, the skills innate in their soul to be painters. Some have the ability to be singers, musicians. Some have the ability to be organized, good at math, intellectual, you know, advanced in tremendous ways, and some people don't. But there's something that every single person has pre-installed, and that is the fear of God, the connection to God. Also the love of God, by the way. Now we're just discussing fear. That fear of God, knowing that we have it, changes the whole process. Why? Let's say I would tell somebody, or somebody would tell me, you know, Moshe, under your front yard is possibly buried, you know, $1 million. Possibly, I'm not going to start digging. What do they say is a 20% chance? You know, at what point will I motivate to actually go and dig? If I am 100% certain that under my front yard is a couple $100 million in jewels, there's no question that I'm going to dig it up and find it. I won't stop till I get it. Why? Because I know it's there. So the first thing we have to do is know that with inside of us, there is that level of godliness, that level of fear, that level of awe, that level of love. Knowing that suddenly makes it no longer we have to create it. We wouldn't have to manufacture this feeling. We have to just tap into it. It's there. It's real. It's part of us. We just have to tap into it. So last week we spoke that there's a very big difference in general between the meditation that one does to connect to something intellectually and to connect to something emotionally. And we explained that there's something called a meditation that brings to intellectual accomplishment and a meditation that brings to an emotional accomplishment. We called it a das meditation or a bina meditation. Are we trying to understand something or trying to connect to something? And we gave all different differences, all different things, how they're different. Today, I want to talk about a little further addressing a few interesting ideas. One of them is the idea of prayer. If you think about it, every single day we have davening over and over and over again. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Shabbos, Sunday, over and over. So we want to explain, I want to say the difference between a davening and Torah study. Torah study is an intellectual experience, and therefore there's a certain way that it's done, which is much more structured and limited versus davening. It's like a difference between a song and a class, or a song and a conversation, a discussion. If you think about a song, which is davening, davening is a song. It's a song because, as we know, song is called the pen of the heart. Someone mentioned today is International Dog Day. Song is the pen of the heart. It is the day, I mentioned dogs because dogs are called, are Hebrew. Kelev is kulei lev, all heart. Songs connect the heart to something. If you think about it, it's amazing. A song, singing it, could put you into a mood of something very low and down and melancholy, or make you very upbeat. And on the contrary, on the other extreme, if you're in a good mood, it's easy to sing a lively song. If you're not in a good mood, it's maybe easy to sing a more depressing song or a down song, or that's what you want to hear. Sometimes having a hard day, you want to hear a Western song. Now, Westerns are You lost your truck, you lost your dog, you lost your wife, you lost, everything's gone. Sometimes that's what's coming from inside of you. And that's why you find a very interesting thing about song, unique from a lecture or a talk. One thing is how often you could listen to the same talk. Imagine someone gives a talk and you listen to it, that's pretty good. The second time around, unless you didn't understand it the first time, you're done. There's no need to hear the same talk a second time or a third time. The rabbis give the same speech every week. It's not easy to listen to it. But a song, if you like the song, you can hear the song over and over and over and over again. Another interesting thing is, when you have a song that you're singing and someone else is singing too, it could be, if they're singing it together with you, it's a beautiful thing. If you're talking and someone else is talking, it's a conflict. Another thing is interesting, you find by songs, oftentimes we like to close our eyes when we sing. Not so much when you talk. When you sing, you like to close your eyes. Singing also, if someone is singing different than you, also within your same pattern, it's called harmony. It's something beautiful about it. If someone's talking different than you, it's very distracting. We find many, many things about song that is different. Why is that? Because song is not an intellectual experience, it's an emotional experience. And emotional experiences we can tap into over and over and over, like reflecting on a good time, remembering a great moment. It's fun to remember good times, and sometimes you need to remember not such good times or remember painful things for whatever reason. But emotional experiences, because they connect to me deeply, there are many, many layers to the depth that I have that can be constantly and repeatedly tapped into. That is why to tap into Das, to feel something, takes a lot of time. You know, if you want to understand something, and you sit down, you figure it out, and you got it. There's no need to figure it out anymore. Like we said last week, if you want to figure out a math equation, and you figured it out, you're done. But if you want to think about something that's going to touch you, even after you got it, you think about it some more, and some more, and some more. And the more you think about it, the more you experience it, because it's the point of that is to change you and to touch you. What we're saying in this chapter is we all have inside of us, on a very deep level, a awe, a connection, a feeling to Hashem. That feeling is real, and it's there, and the way to tap into it is by repeatedly meditating, but not in an intellectual way, in an emotional meditation. Think about it, feel it. And if it doesn't work once, try again. Eventually you'll feel it. It's like somebody wants to irritate you. All they gotta do is spend a little more time and I guarantee you'll be irritated. And the same thing works, by the way, in every area of emotional. If someone's being tempted with a temptation they shouldn't do, the longer the temptation goes on, the more it's possible to get caught into it. Because our nature is, emotionally, we get pulled. That's how we get more angry, more excited, more. The more we spend time with something, the more it pulls us in. So if you want to tap into a feeling, it requires a meditating and not thinking like numbers or abstract ideas, but try and think about, for an example, someone who you love, someone you care about, how they impact you. The more you think about it, the more you'll have a feeling to them. Then we said something which is the key we have to address here, and that is the challenge that we have. What is that challenge? The challenge is twofold. The first challenge is that our souls are different. Every single person that you encounter, including members of your own family, have different types of souls, meaning different ways they get inspired. There are some people that you talk to them and in 30 seconds they're crying. Some people, they're like a stone wall. They don't get emotional, at least not that you see it. Sometimes they have the emotions, but they have a good facade. But some people have a hard time getting emotionally affected by something. Same thing is spiritually. Some people are very easily spiritually inspired. Something happens, it could be standing in Niagara Falls, it could be hearing some good news, it could be something just a day of the year, the yard side of a person, and you're just feeling a tremendous spiritual feeling. And some people are just dull, they don't feel it. And that has to do with your soul. Your neshama is different, how it comes down here. Just like there's artistic souls, and there are souls that are better at thinking, souls that are better at creating, some are morning people, night people, I'm a visual person, I'm an audio person. There are spiritual people that are much more easily tapped into it. And then there's experiences in our life that blockage. What does that mean? If a person has done a sin, And the Alter Rebbe here mentions a very unique sin in our chapter. He mentions sins of our youth. He's referring to sexually related sins, inappropriate behaviors, whether it's premarital, during a marriage, and other ways. And he's not saying what it means here. When he says the word chateis na'urim, we know it refers to all those inappropriate sins of intimacy. Why does he mention that here? And it's a good point to mention something we mentioned a very long time ago, but to mention it again now. In Judaism, very different than other religions, not all other religions, but primarily from Christianity, intimacy is the most powerful tool a human being has and a Jew has. When I say powerful, I mean spiritual. It is the highest and most powerful tool. The bedroom in a home is called the Holy of Holies. There's an idea that says that if a man and woman are appropriate with each other, God dwells with them, the third partner in creation. It's talking about the time of intimacy. The time of intimacy is considered the most loftiest spiritual thing. A Kohen Gadol that wasn't married couldn't be the Kohen Gadol. As a matter of fact, he had to have a backup wife. Like you have in football, a second string quarterback. If God forbid, on the eve of Yom Kippur, his wife would die, God forbid, he had a backup person that was ready to marry him immediately, so he shouldn't be without a wife. Not that he could be with her that night, but just so he shouldn't be unmarried because of the tremendous power of a married person. In Judaism, it's a big deal. I don't want to go into that length. It's another good discussion, but it's a spiritual, it's a very lofty spiritual engagement, the relationship with the husband and the wife, intimately. And therefore, it is the most destructive force too. We know whenever you have a great tzaddik, the possibility of having a child that's a sinner or becoming a sinner is the highest. The more power there is energy spiritually, the more decrepit it could become. We find in our society, and not just our society, going back to the Romans, the Egyptians, the Babylonians, the Greeks, I don't have to go that far, go back an hour ago to the world, the greatest area of inappropriate, considered decrepit behavior is in this particular field. And that's where the worst sins can happen, the most inappropriate behaviors, the most degrading. And it's not just that it's degrading its behavior. One of the reasons, just so you know, because the sin that he primarily refers to is wasting of seed. And the reason why that's considered such a big deal in Judaism has nothing to do with whether it's enjoyable or not. It has to do with that the greatest tool that God gave us is the ability to create a child. It's the most godly thing we can do. And when you waste that, it's the most, imagine someone came out with a vaccine or a healing for COVID-19. And someone gets it and they start spilling them out on the floor, wasting them. Are you kidding me? That's the most precious thing we have today. Solve the world's problems. So when you waste this particular physical energy, the seed, or the spiritual energy, you're creating the most dangerous thing. And that is blockage. Why blockage? If you remember in chapter, blockage, you mean of the sensitivities of your heart and your mind. If you remember in the very beginning, we mentioned a very interesting idea that biologically it's hard to understand, but when you understand Hasidus, it's not so difficult. And that is, it says a seed of the father comes from the brain, comes from the mind. What does it mean? So I want to try and figure out what this means. I Googled it, I looked it up. There's a Muslim belief that there's actually seed that slides down the spine and comes out during relations. And Hasidus, it means it's a feeling. It's an electronic pulse that starts off in the brain as electronic or a pulse. And by the time it affects and comes out of the body, it comes out as a seed. But it starts off in the brain. In other words, this particular resource is connected to the brain very, very much. And how you conduct yourself will affect you completely in your sensitivity. And therefore, the Alter Rebbe says here, if somebody in their youth or in their lifetime has done sins, particularly related to this area, it gives them it desensitizes them to feel spirituality. And the only way to heal this is to meditate and to think and to work on yourself to grow. In other words, there are two possibilities why we have something blocking our spiritual feelings. Either past inappropriate relationships, anything related to intimacy, or, which is more common, our souls. That our souls come from a place that's different and doesn't have the same ability to tune into spirituality. In other words, it's a difference of nature, our souls, or nurture here would mean experiences that desensitized us. And by the way, this desensitizing idea is real. I was reading a book about the training that they do in the Israeli military to prepare them for war. One of the things that they do is, unfortunately, is they have the soldiers come in contact in visual and all different ways of very severe wounds, very severe injuries of a person. Otherwise, the first time, God forbid, someone sees a very severe body torn apart by a bomb blast or by a grenade, they could fall apart completely. And one of the things they do is they work to desensitize the soldiers. They shouldn't be easily affected by traumatic experiences. To overcome the trauma of battle and maybe have less PTSD or not, I don't know. But one thing for sure is it desensitizes them. And we see today in the society, a lot of people, because of the level of availability on the internet and in the movies and everywhere, a lot of the youth today are growing up completely desensitized to the refined nature of something which is meaningful in relationships. And by the way, as an example, Manus Friedman once gave an interesting talk, and he said that somebody came over to him and said, "What's with you rabbis? You're so perverted. You can't shake a woman's hand? Are you so messed up that if you shake a woman's hand, you're all like, it's an experience that's inappropriate to you? It's a handshake. That doesn't mean anything." And Manus Friedman responded, "That's the problem. A handshake means nothing to you. A handshake should be a meaningful engagement, a touch. Should mean something. It should have an experience associated with it. We lost sensitivity. And if we're losing sensitivity in this area, it's a reflection of sensitivity being lost in our spiritual understanding, because the bottom line is intimacy and spirituality are one. Each one could be used for good. Each one could be used for bad. Each one could be harnessed in a tremendous way of connection to Hashem. That being said, so the Alter Rebbe says, how does one get past it? So, to get to that, this is what today's topic is going to be about. And to understand that, the first, let's talk for a moment about a very interesting thing about Hashem made us. Hashem made the human beings, and probably all creatures, but primarily human beings, that we need to sleep. Approximately, the suggested amount usually is 8 hours a night. I don't know who really gets that. That's 8 hours a night, which is really one third of a day. 3 times 8 is 24. So it's one third of a day. So a person lives to be 90 years old. That means you spend 30 years of your life sleeping. Now that's a happy thought. Imagine, 30 years of your life, if you were following your doctor's recommendation, you spent horizontal asleep or on a couch in your house. But the bottom line is, why would Hashem make us in such a way that we require sleep? Why? Why couldn't Hashem make us that we don't need sleep? He could have made it, by the way, the same way. Your heart doesn't rest. Your heart beats 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 a year, for 120 years. If God forbid it stops, it's a problem. Why can't your mind and your mouth and everything else work the same way? Why your heart doesn't say, you know what? I'm going to take a break for 7 hours and I'll get up in the morning. No, the heart goes. And the answer is, it's the greatest gift that Hashem gave us. And that is, every day is a new experience. There's other reasons given, but Chassidus explains, Hashem understands our unique psyche. And that is, we have sometimes off days, or not such good days, or unpleasant days, or days that we didn't like the way they turned out. If the day would never end, that experience would be very hard to get past. But Hashem gave you a gift, gave me a gift. Go to sleep, wake up, tomorrow's a fresh day. One of the famous expressions Hasidim have, our teachers will tell us, yeshiva, tomorrow's going to be a better day. Margiv azayin garadish, tomorrow is a fresh day. In other words, Hashem gave us the gift of every day being a new start. It's a fresh start, a new day. Yesterday's problems are yesterday, start fresh. And not just every day, but every year. Why did Hashem make it that there's a new year every year? Rosh Hashanah is coming up in a few weeks. Yes, only about 3 weeks. Why does it have to be every year a brand new year, new fresh start? The answer is because we need it. We're human beings. We have flaws. We make mistakes. We're imperfect. And if we don't get a second chance to start again, so Hashem gives us second chances, third chances, 100 chances, 1,000 chances. Every day is a new beginning. The Rebbe once told somebody, the reason why a birthday is called a birthday and not the day you turn 25, why do we call it a birthday? Why shouldn't it be your advancing day? Well, birth happened, you know, get over it. You were born 50 years ago. Or in other words, the Rebbe says, the key is to live each day like it's your first. He says, some people like to say, live each day like it's your last. The Rebbe says, no, live each day like it's your first. It's a birthday. Why? The number one reason we don't do certain things in life is because something that happened before holding us back. There's some baggage. I had an argument with a guy. I got into a disagreement. Had a bad experience. I got embarrassed in public. I did something I shouldn't. Your yesterday holds you back. The Rebbe says if you live each day like it's the first day in your life, like it's your birthday, I was born today, nothing's holding you back from yesterday. There's no, you never got mad at their rabbi. You never got mad at your sister. You never got mad at this person. You didn't do something wrong. Yesterday is done. Today's a fresh day. So the gift of sleeping is that break between yesterday and today, the new year. The problem is, maybe there's a new year, but it's the same me. What do I gain if the new year has the same me? If I would be given a new me, I could understand. So this is the key that we're saying in this chapter. And this is the message of this class, this whole piece of Tanya. You don't need a new you. You don't need a change. You got to find the old you, meaning you got to get back to the you. In other words, the Rebbe once spoke, and he says there's three words that people mistranslate. The word teshuvah, the word tefillah, and the word tzedakah. Tzedakah people mean as charity. Tzedakah doesn't mean charity. It means justice. The right thing is, if you have the ability to help someone else out, you should. You're not being charitable, you're being appropriate. Charitable is if you're doing something you shouldn't do. A proper conduct is, if you're walking in a park, and you have the guy next to you who's hungry, doesn't have a sandwich, and you have two sandwiches, you give him one. It's, of course, it's tzedakah, but it's not being charitable. It's being appropriate and right. The next word is tefillah. Tefillah, people translate it as prayer. It doesn't mean to pray. It means to connect. Tefillah is like the word tefillin, tying something. You're connecting. Davening is a time to connect to Hashem. As you mentioned, to feel it. Song, it means something. I'm inspired by it. I'm touched. The whole point of davening is to be inspired and feel something, not to say words. It's got to connect to you. Connect to Hashem. And finally, teshuva. The word teshuva, people translate, we got to change. I got to become a new person. No, teshuva means return to yourself. Teshuva means go back to the real you. They say the difference between a spiritual leader and a psychologist is a psychologist looks inside you to find the mud, to find the bad. What's causing you to do these things wrong? And there's a famous Sigmund Freud. He says the essence of a person is not so pleasant, a selfish individual. Chassidus looks inside you, a spiritual tzad looks inside you to find the good. Meaning, who is the real you? Stop being you. In other words, the question is not, how do I return? The question is, how did I sin in the first place? It's a whole change of understanding our identity. Meaning, what we have to do in this chapter, he's telling us, and this is the gift of Moshe Rabbeinu, is not to change ourselves, but to create a feeling for God. It's just to uncover it. All we got to do is access it. And that's what we're saying here of the metaphor of these meditations, is not to try and create love. You don't need to have a child to create a love to their parents. You got to find out what's getting in the way. Did something happen to you? Did they offend you? Did they insult you? Why are you having an issue with your parents? You didn't have to explain. Let me tell you why you should love your parents. That's not what's needed. You have to remove it. And sometimes the way to remove it is not to focus on the negative, but to increase the positive. As we know, there are two ways to heal a person. One is to take that particular limb and try and heal it. And one is to have a holistic increase in the body's overall health, the way you eat and the way you exercise and the way you do things. And sometimes you need both. But the point is, what we're saying here is the meditation that we need to do is not to create a love or a fear to God. It's to uncover it, to access it. And how is that done? That's what we're talking about here. He said, quote the Baal Shem Tov, and he quotes King Solomon in this chapter here. And that is, King Solomon says, you have to search for God like you search for a treasure. What does that mean? Know that it's there. If you know you have a treasure, the whole search is different. Or as the Baal Shem Tov put it, Yisrael is a land of desire. Any way you search, you know, all of our homes in Mequon, or most of us, we have wells in our backyard. How do they know where to dig? It doesn't matter where they dig. They're going to find water. The question is it 60 feet down or 900 feet down? I was talking once to a guy digging our new well a few years ago. He said the deepest well he dug in Mequon was like 1,000 feet or something. They're going to find water. The question is how much effort, how much rocks in the way, how much mud's in the way, how much sand, and how do you bring it to the surface? And that's what we said. The first thing we have to do is lessen our indulgence in material things. And the second thing we have to do is get more inspired in our spiritual things. Become more inspired. Lift bring it to the surface. But there's no need to create a new feeling. Let's see this inside. I'm going to go through rather quickly because I spoke this outside, but it's a lot of very interesting technical details here. We're on page Samach, which is page 119 if you have the regular Tanya. There's no number there, but it's the top number, 119. And he says, top line, the third word, Ukmasha Amara Zal, like our sages tell us, Yigaiti Umatsasi Tamin. If someone says, I worked hard and I succeed, believe him. What it says before that is, he doesn't quote it here because the Alt-Rev is positive. It says, the guy says, I tried and I didn't succeed, don't believe him. He's not talking about becoming an artist or learning how to fly an airplane or learning how to do certain acrobats. He's talking about tapping into your neshama. If someone says, I tried to feel it, and I tried, I don't get it. You didn't try hard enough. There's an actually interesting story with one of the students of the Magid that he came back to his, those days was a very strong, unfortunate opposition to Hasidim, not to Chabad, to all Hasidim, in times of the Baal Shem Tov already. And they felt it was this new cult. They called it the cult. And they were very against Hasidism. So one person goes over to this guy who became a Hasid. He says, so tell me, what did you learn in your time by the Magid of Mizrich? What did you gain? He said, what did I gain? I gained the ability to read minds. He says, to what? He says, I can read your mind. He says, I'll tell you what you're thinking about right now. He says, tell me. He says, right now you're thinking about God. He says, actually, you guys are a farce. No, I'm not. Haven't thought about God all day today. He says, that's why I went to the Magid, because I think about God the whole day. In other words, your effort, what's required to transform ourselves is to be focused on our true self, our true identity. We're going to see at the end of this page, we're not going to get there today, but next week we'll do it. He's going to ask a question. How could somebody feel God if you can't see him? He doesn't have a body. He doesn't have eyes. He doesn't have a head. He doesn't have a physical form. How could you relate to it? That's the question we're going to get to soon. Because when we're going to meditate and think about something, you have to have some form of meditation. So today, of course, we're living in a world where these questions are so much easier to answer. You know, in Hebrew school, we like to ask the kids if they believe in things that you can't see and you can't touch and you can't hear. And I say, who believes in Wi-Fi? The obvious answer is everyone believes in Wi-Fi. It's the number one commodity for a teenager today. You walk into it, we do trips with the teens, we get to a destination, what's the Wi-Fi password? Because the bottom line is, we learn that there are things that we can't see and can't touch and can't feel. How do we know they're there? We see their impact. We see the effect. The way you know there's Wi-Fi is not because you see Wi-Fi. You see the effect and the change within your phone. Suddenly you have reception. Suddenly there's activity going on. Same thing with gravity. Same thing with radio waves. So today it's easier than it was in times of the Alter Rebbe. In times of the Alter Rebbe, when he asked this question, it was a much harder question. How do we accept an existence we can't see? But we'll get to that. Continuing inside, if a person will search, King Solomon says, the same way you search for silver or gold, if you know you have it there, you will be successful. Why? Because you know you have it there. That's the key. The difference between a successful search and a non-successful search is based really on one thing. Do you know it's there? If they know there's diamonds in a mine, they're going to start digging for it, and they'll invest tremendous, tremendous money and resources to dig for the diamonds. If they don't know what's there, they'll do a couple casual inspections and move on. It's like a person searches for a treasure that's hidden underground, that he searches with tremendous effort. A person has to dig and work with tremendous effort to reveal the treasure house of fear of God that's hidden and concealed within the heart of every single Jew. So this is fact number one. Every single Jew has inside of himself pre-installed fear of God. We start off this chapter. Moshe Rabbeinu told us fear of God is easy if you can access it. A Rebbe helps us access it. But at the end of the day, we got to do the work ourselves. You can't rely on Moshe. You can't rely on a Rebbe. You got to go yourself and do the hard work. It's like an oxygen tank under the water. You have to have your own. You can't rely on someone else doing it. That won't do it for you. You need your own oxygen tank, your own source of oxygen and food and sustenance to do what needs to be done. Shehi bechinas u'madrega shel ma'ila ma'azman. This level of godliness inside of us is higher than the limitations of time. On one hand, that's a great thing, because if I sinned, it's like I never sinned. Imagine something above time. I don't have a problem with something that happened in the past because this is above time. The problem with above time is it's harder to connect to it. Imagine if I tell you, I have good news for you. I have a treasure that's buried so deep it will never get lost. But it's buried so deep, it's very hard to access. Meaning, the benefit of a soul, depth of fear of God, which is very removed or very, very in a safe, much in a safe place, has the benefit that it can't be tarnished. The essence of our soul can't be tarnished. You eat pork, on Yom Kippur, riding a motorcycle, cursing out God, God forbid, and you won't affect the drop, the essence of your soul. You're just as pure and Jewish as you were before you did that, because you can't hurt the essence of your soul. But it's hard to tap into it. It takes effort. Just like it's very hard to hurt it, it's almost impossible. Same thing, it's very hard to tap into it. It takes effort. And we're referring to the natural fear of God that every Jew has. So we started off at the beginning of Tanya 42 chapters ago, that Avram, Yitzhak, and Yaakov gave us a natural love and fear of God. We have Moshe Rabbeinu was able to shine a light and wake it up. The Rebbe of our generation, and each generation helps the people of that generation make it come alive, helps you bring it to the surface. But at the end of the day, we got to tap into ourselves. The good news is, it's there. As a rabbi once said by a fundraiser, not our rabbi, but a rabbi, he says, we have good news and bad news. The good news is we have all the money we need to build a new shul. The bad news is it's in your pockets. In other words, the resource is there, but it takes effort on your part to make it happen. It's just that have to bring to the surface this feeling which is lying dormant inside of you, that it should affect you in avoiding sin in action and in speech and in thought. You have to reveal it from the deep resources where it's hidden inside your heart, which is higher than time. You have to think about it and meditate about it and try and entertain the thought in your mind. To spend time thinking about this. And by the way, it's incredible how these things work, even a little bit, but it takes a lot of time for it to have a huge effect. As the previous Rebbe said in the letter of 1932, that we mentioned about a month ago, how long does it take, someone asked. He said, an hour a day, 7 days a week, 30 days a month, 15 to 20 years. Then you could be sure. In other words, some people it could happen in a month. Some people it takes even longer. But the bottom line is, this is the journey of our life. The journey of our life, and this is one of the things we said in chapters 14, 15, 16, and 17, has nothing to do with achieving success. It's the journey to success. So a person works all their life and never gets there. That wasn't your mission. God didn't need you to be a tzaddik. He needed you to work on yourself and be on the journey. Some people's mission is to be a tzaddik, and they have a different life, a different role. They're called the lifeguards. They're called the medical response team. But the regular people on the ski hill, their job is to try and figure out and work out. It's a guy in the gym. There's never really a day that he's done. He's always working out. He's always exercising, always running. You don't say, okay, you know what? I've been exercising for 5 years, I'm done now. No, you're not. Because as soon as you stop trying, you start slacking. It's a constant battle. Some people have a beautiful physique, you know, with a perfect fit body. And some people maintain a healthy body. And some people just good cardio health. Everyone's different. The main thing is the effort and the journey and the work that we do. And it takes effort. It takes a lot of work to bring it from potential into actual results. And that means that you actually affect not only to avoid doing sin, we also start doing more mitzvahs. The machshava, dibur, maisa, and thought, and speech, and action. Now this is a beautiful expression here. We're going to finish with these two lines today. These two lines. And this is the line that we say on Rosh Hashanah when we sound the shofar. We have, it's how Hashem searches and awaits and watches. We started off in this chapter, in the chapter 41. We said how Hashem is so lofty and so great and so this. And yet, he puts everything aside of all of the frat that looks upon you. So now he's making the full circle. You want to know how to be certain that you've achieved this concept of connecting to Hashem is when you realize that Hashem is looking and he's watching and he's paying attention and he's checking to see what decision are you going to make right now. In the year, today is August 26, 2020. At 11:38, you have a choice to do A or to do B. Are you going to work on yourself to try and overcome the challenge, even if you don't succeed? Even if you push it off for 5 minutes, a person's working to have a cheeseburger, not to have the cheeseburger. And you know what? You work, after 5 minutes, you give in. Hashem has such a joy that you pushed it off for 5 minutes. You might say, but I failed. No, you didn't. Because last time you had a cheeseburger, you ate it without thinking. And today you waited 5 minutes. It's a different you. It's a whole new level of yourself coming to the surface. So the true identity has nothing to do with the success rate of the final action. It has to do with, is there a change in you from yesterday? Have you become more in touch with the real you today? Is the real you more at the surface? Are you bothered by it? Are you bothered that you're not bothered by it? There's a whole talk of the Rebbe that some people are bothered by sin. Some people are bothered that the sin doesn't bother them. And some people are bothered that they don't even care. And the Rebbe said, that's something too. If it bothers you that you become completely indifferent to sin, that also is something. And by the way, I have friends of mine, one particular friend I'm thinking of right now, who used to be a regular Hasidic Lubavitch Bacher. He now, he's married, he has kids, and he's not at all religious. And he's changed a lot, and he's had challenges in life, and a wonderful person, tremendous person. So I asked him once, does he ever go visit the Rebbe's grave? Because he lives out of New York, but he's in New York once or twice a year. He says, I can't. I don't feel appropriate facing the Rebbe. I'm like, what a tzaddik you are. I said, you know how authentic you are? You're basically telling me is that with all your personal journey that you're on, you know that you're not exactly where you should be. That means you have the full sensitivity, but it's a different part of the journey. We all have, you think the guy next to you, me, myself, the other person, doesn't have areas where we could get over our failings. We're all human. We all have struggles. You are authentic because you're in touch with a party that doesn't allow you to be fake. You going to the Rebbe's grave, you think you're being fake. You're disrespecting him in your personal journey. I told him, the Rebbe loves you anyway, trust me. I'm not an expert on Rebbe's, but just a little bit that I know is he'll be happy to see you and he doesn't judge you because he understands you and your challenges better than you do. And he understands the choices you made, the journey you're on, and he will be much more justifying your behavior than you can ever do. And that's something that the Rebbe taught us. You don't know a person's journey, why they make these choices. But in any case, getting back to just to finish off these two lines here, so Pei Hashem, Hatsoife, he's looking, Soife usually is from afar, it's like Har Tzof in the Mount Scopus. Umabit, he looks him close, Umazin, he listens to him, Makshiv, he pays attention, Umaven, he understands, El Kol Maaseyu, in all your actions, Uboichin Kliyesev, he looks inside your kidneys, he's looking inside your, in your kishkes, he means, he's looking in your kishkes, what are you feeling right now? And your heart, like it says, is stock of a divine. If a person would think about three things, that the eye that sees, that the ears that hears, and all your stuff already written down, you would act differently. Because Hashem is actually watching you right now, and he wants to know what is Moshe going to do today. How is he going to, is he going to bench from a bencher or not? Is he going to make a comment to offend that person, even though it's funny or not? Is he, how is he going to experience it? Even though 2 minutes later, I might do something much worse. It doesn't matter. I'm watching you right now. Each experience matters, each thing. Like Marty Stein had this great line. He would say, he talks about this guy who's walking on the beach, and there's tens and thousands of starfish along the whole beach that in the storm washed up, and now they can't swim back, so they're drying out in the sun, they're dying. So a guy's walking by and picking up starfish and throwing it back into the water. So that person says to him, Mister, there's miles and miles and miles of beach. There's hundreds of thousands of starfish. Do you really think what you're doing makes a difference? And he picked up a starfish. The guy that picks it up, he says, well, to this one, it makes a difference. And he throws it into the water. And that's what we have to know. Every hour we live, every minute we live, every day we're alive, it's a minute that came from heaven and going back. And we mentioned a few weeks ago, it's a time is a creation that comes in every hour and goes back every hour. To that hour, it makes a difference how we lived. Because that hour goes back home to God and never comes back again. And then the next hour comes. So maybe the next hour was not lived in the most perfect way, but this hour was a good hour, and it goes back home in a good way. And that's what he says, Hashem is watching to see, and if you think about this, you would never do a sin. So back to our question, so how could a person do a sin? We said before, a person, the question is not, how could I ever do tshuva? The question is, how did I ever sin in the first place? So that we could talk about maybe next week when we get a little further, why a person would sin in the first place. And basically, the short answer is, because we weren't thinking. The short answer is, it was temporary foolishness, maybe call it insanity, meaning it was a moment I didn't think. It's like somebody said, why didn't you say that to your mother? Why didn't you say that to the person? You're right, I should have said it. It was foolish. It was a mistake. I didn't think. If we would think for a moment, it would take away a lot of the fun in life. But if we thought for a moment before we did each thing, we would reconsider many things. Our favorite thing to do is when we want to do something we shouldn't, is not to allow ourselves to think. Because it says in the Talmud, if you ever want to do a sin, it's talking about sins of sexuality, or if you ever want to do a sin, don't tell yourself not to do it. Just tell yourself, I'll do it in 1 hour, or I'll do it tomorrow morning. Because you'll see you're not going to do it tomorrow morning. Sins are done in a moment of passion when you don't allow your brain to think. You think with your heart, with your blood flow. So this is the point, he says. You want to know how not to sin? Think. Meditate. The more you meditate, the more hard it is to do it. If you meditate long enough on each of these things, it takes away the ability to do something wrong. And your fear of God comes to the surface. We'll stop here. It's 10:45. This is a question on something we said, but this is a very practical sort of meditation chapter where we can tap into this idea that Moshe Rabbeinu says that fearing God is easy. Yeah, if you think about it. If you allow yourself to meditate upon it, not that it's easy, but it's accessible. Because the truth is, and this is something we shouldn't kid ourselves, there's nothing in Judaism that's easy. And there's nothing in life that's meaningful and worthwhile that comes easy. In other words, when something is difficult, it's usually a sign that it's much more valuable. And when I say nothing's easy, it doesn't mean there aren't things that ever came easy in life. I mean, the good things take effort. Best example is the tomatoes that you plant and grow yourself are so much more precious than the ones you pick up in Sendix. Even if yours look like from Chernobyl. Yours look like they came from Chernobyl. They're like a weird shaped tomato. But I grew it myself. The value of something that you worked hard for. I was talking yesterday to a teenage boy who's starting to prepare for his next level in life. And I was explaining to him about things that you work hard for. I said, you know, if your mom gave you for Hanukkah, you know, $20, you could spend it like this. But if you babysitted for a couple of days and you earned $20, you would think five times how to spend the money. Because that money means something to me because it came with effort and work. That's how life is. So Yiddishkeit, the truth is, there is nothing that comes easy. There are times in life when the excitement is fast, when something's new. A boy started to put on tefillin, someone just became religious. Suddenly Shabbos is exciting, mitzvahs are exciting. But someone, once you're religious for a year or two, the original adrenaline is gone. Now it has to become real. And that's how marriages work. And that's how relationships with Hashem work. That's how everything works. The easy stuff is not the authentic stuff. It's the stuff that you work to develop that's authentic. Anyway, have a great day. And I'm actually going to New York today to my brother Peres making a wedding. If anybody wants to text me a name or WhatsApp me or whatever, email me a name to mention by the Rebbe's grave, I'm going tomorrow morning to the grave at about 10 o'clock in the morning, 9 o'clock. So if you want to, any time today, you send me something, I will write it down and put the name in the Rebbe's grave. And Hashem should bless us all with a healthy, a sweet, and a good year.
Amen. Thank you, Moshe.
Thank you, Moshe.
Thank you, Moshe.
What
is the email if I want to send to you? What is your email?
Oh, Moshe, M-O-S-H-E, at chabadmekwan.org.
Can we send it to your text message or sure. WhatsApp message, Rabbi?
Sure,
thank
sure.
You.
So what I do is whenever I go these days to the oil, I take like 15 minutes and I check all the texts and emails I got before I go inside because I usually get a number of them. So I'll write them down and you don't have to write any information. Just give me the names and I'll mention them. The information, you talk to God directly, what you need the blessing for.
So, Rabbi, I have a tiny question.
Yes.
So, and I wrote you some minutes before. So that's why Moshe wrote several songs in the Chumash, and Miriam also wrote a song. It's connected to the first thing that you spoke about?
I don't know. It could be. Those songs are a different type of song. So I don't know if, in general, that's a real point. Songs are a whole different story. I don't know how to apply that to the Chumash songs because I'm not familiar enough with why those were written as songs and what that means. So I don't know the answer. I'm not sure.
Okay.
I have a thought regarding that also. And I don't know where I got this from, but years ago I learned that the wheels of our soul are a song, a song. That's how the soul travels, is with song. And I just, you know, been tuning into the Chabad.org, and they have the daily Tehillim, and they chant it. And it's so much better chanted. And it's just a thought, like, check into it. You can get all the Tehillim, you sign up for Chabad.org. And it's just an amazing thing to experience the Tehillim chanted versus struggling through it. Anyway, just a thought.
And Joan, on the same note, davening, if you ever sing the davening, or even before you start to sing to yourself, it's a much more meaningful experience. Like Shabbos morning is easier to do it because we're not rushing, or depends where you're davening. Yeah. But in general, a time to of song is davening. It's a beautiful thing to take the time and sing davening. And the old Hasidim, when I say old, I mean the authentic ones. New is the new modern guys like me that, you know, we just rush through life. But the authentic Hasidic experience is davening should be done with song.
Yeah.
The whole thing.
Sure. Another thought, another question that I had was, for example, we know that Abraham Avinu was the first quote-unquote convert. So when we spoke about the three inappropriate words and you thought of, you spoke about tshuva, could it be in a way when Hashem told Abraham, lech lecha, it's the same, go to yourself, go to your...
Yes. That's, I mean, I said the three words, you mean the three words that are mistranslated. Yeah, that's the talk of the Rebbe. Yeah, lech lecha means, by the way, go to yourself. That is the definition of lech lecha. That's what God said to him. Go to your true self, your true identity. As you know, that the soul that we mentioned in the second chapter of Tanya, which was installed in Adam, but Hashem blew into his nostrils, it said that jumped forward to Avram Avinu. We don't find the travel to all the people between Adam and Avram, but which was almost, it was 1948 years, but it was to Avram was the one who got it, and that was bequeathed to all of us. So yeah, lech lecha means go to the real you, get in touch with yourself, which by the way is the essence of Hasidus, letting the real us come out, not being distracted by our outside self. And the trick is to make them connected. It's very hard. Because sometimes in the middle self, which we spoke about a lot in the earlier chapters, that we confuse with our real self. I don't want to get completely sidetracked, but there's our outside self with the action, there's the real us, and there's the guy in the middle, which is the current feeling we have. Just an example is when you're on a real diet that you're trying to lose weight and you're coming to Bar Mitzvah, they have this rich buffet. So you want that piece of, let's say, cookie or cake or whatever the food is. So the real you doesn't want it. The active you wants it. And the outside you has to find out, do I eat it? Because why should I be a faker? I want it. But you say, no, I don't really want it. Deep down, I don't want it. So which is your current want is your, is like the RAM of your body, what's currently accessed. But the real you would rather, when you got home that night and you didn't have the cake, you'll go, oh, I'm so happy. Why? Because I didn't want to have it. I thought you did. That was not the real me. That was my excited me. That was my, you know, surface me. And the trick is that the outside functioning me should be in tune with the real me and not with the excited me. And that's the three layers that we say of the, when Hashem made the holy ark, the outside was gold. The very inside was gold. The middle was a layer of wood. That wood could rot. And that's the identity of a Jew, that we have to know the inside we have is gold. Outside, we should try and be gold. And if in the middle there's wood, I mean, it's not so valuable. Don't worry. That's not the real you. It's the animal soul. It's the functioning you that tries to, that could rot. And that's, anyway. Have a good day. And then we'll see everyone next week, next Wednesday.